As a public health professional and industrial hygienist, I often get asked about my background, which is in the mining field. And I like to point out to people that the reason that we mine materials is because society demands it. And it's just not just mining, it's not just oil and gas and extractive industries, it's not just manufacturing. There are thousands of industries that produce the things that society demands. Take electrical vehicles, for example. They require dozens of metals and hundreds of chemicals to produce. One recent study showed that with our current mining technology and methods, for copper alone, it would take 400 years to produce enough copper so that every consumer in the United States could have an electrical vehicle. The point is, society demands thousands of products and materials of industry. Many of these industries are inherently dangerous, and workers in these industries have to work thousands of feet underground in extreme environments, or they may have to work long, physically demanding shifts. Our job as industrial hygienists is to protect the health and the safety of these workers. As industrial hygienists, we like to emphasize and prioritize engineering controls over administrative and personal controls. There's a time and a place for every type of control, but I want to demonstrate why personal controls can introduce challenges to industrial workers. All right, let's get to work. So, can you hear me okay? Do you think I can hear okay? How hard do you think it is to walk up several flights of stairs with this extra resistance that the respirator provides? I may not hear my coworker communicating with me. I may not hear the backup alarm for the heavy piece of equipment behind me, or the emergency sirens. My safety glasses are going to get fogged up. They're going to get chipped. They're going to get cracked. All of these make it harder for me to do my work, let alone to do it safely. If we as industrial hygienists do our job and do it well, with engineering controls, we can start to remove the necessity for PPE. And our workers will be able to do their job more easily. I want to walk through a quick thought experiment, and I often have to remind myself of this because I forget the impact that these industrial workers have on my own day-to-day life. The next time you turn on the light switch, I want you to think about what it took to make that light go on. We're gonna walk through some of the examples. These are not even close to all of the workers, all of the people required to make your light turn on. But I would estimate that at least 10,000 people were directly involved in making that happen. Your power probably comes from oil and gas, coal, and nuclear power. Those materials required to produce electricity have to be extracted, refined, and transported to power plants before we can get electricity. Even solar panels and batteries require dozens of metals and hundreds of chemicals that have to be mined, refined, transported, and manufactured. For industry to produce those products and materials, we need people who are willing to work thousands of feet underground in extreme conditions and long, physically demanding jobs. As industrial hygienists, our goal and our mission is to protect the health of those workers, to make sure that they can enjoy their retirement, play with their grandkids, and have meaningful conversations with their loved ones. We also work hard to protect the health of the environment and the communities where this work is done. At Tulane University, the vision of our graduate degree program in industrial hygiene is to protect the health of communities and workers by training the most competent industrial hygienists in the world. To learn more about industrial hygiene and what our program can do for you, check out the link in the description below. And I hope that you will join me in this important work.